Welcome back to From the Bridge. I'm your captain, Rick Jones of Fishbait Solutions. It's the early days of summer here in the Carolina Lowcountry, and we're already watching the tropics for signs of hurricanes. Trying to reason with hurricane season is a popular pastime. From now until early November, we will keep our eyes on the coast of Africa for any new storms that may become hurricanes. And as we hope for the best, we have to prepare for the worst. We make sure the generator is working. We clear room in the garage for porch and other outdoor furniture. We store bottled water and canned goods. We keep our most important documents in a suitcase in case we have to leave the island. In other words, we prepare. Today's episode is all about preparations. My special guest is Sharon Outram from FieldX, who will talk about how her company helps prepare young people and businesses alike for what's ahead. Someone once said that luck is when preparation meets opportunity. All I know is the more prepared I am, the luckier I seem to be. I am constantly doing scenario planning at our agency. I'm looking ahead and projecting what we might need to make us more effective. Those who know me know that I'm analog man, who still uses dozens and dozens of yellow pads to write things down. But I am smart enough to know that we are needing new technologies and tools to help us as we grow. We recently signed up for Sponsor United to help us better target sales prospects. We became a DigiDeck customer to help us build both better sales presentations, but also to know who opens these presentations and how much time they pay attention to what we send them. My other agency, Engagement, uses Slack effectively to communicate and organize projects. So we're looking at using Slack too here at Fishbait. We are blessed that Fishbait is growing significantly. That means we are needing additional staff. I keep a running list of people I'd like to have join us at Fishbait once we have a need for their talents. And if COVID-19 taught us anything, it's that things can quickly change whether we like it or not. So all businesses and families need to plan for financial reserves. This year is about recovery from the difficulties of 2020 and paying down the debt we accumulated last year. That takes both preparation and discipline. Discipline, yeah. Yet another trait we'll spend time talking about soon. Coach Wooden once said, by failing to prepare, you are preparing to fail. So here's the question of the day. How prepared are you? Let's now climb back up on the old soapbox. You all know I love sayings. My first book, Analog Advice in a Digital World, is a collection of sayings. One of my favorite sayings that is not in that book is the old Greek saying that a wise man plants trees from whence he'll never enjoy the shade. Now that's real preparation. Preparation for decades and generations to come. Sadly, I don't see many trees being planted in politics these days. We have run up incredible amounts of debt that we're going to be leaving for our children and our grandchildren to deal with. And no one from either political party seems to care. College sports doesn't seem to be much better. I've watched a lot of athletic directors retire this year. Why? Because it just got a whole lot harder than it was before COVID-19. But COVID alone did not create the long-term issues facing college athletics. Issues like how to facilitate and manage and possibly even fund name, image, and likeness for student athletes, or how to handle social justice and equality issues, or how to continue to pay for sports that don't create much income, how to find new income sources, how to build loyalty with a couple of generations that have not shown loyalty to much of anything. Here's my advice for you new ADs. You'd better start planting some trees. My guest angler today is my friend Sharon Outram. Sharon and I became friends when she was working at Prime Sport. We did a lot of things together when I was running the marketing initiatives for the National Association of Basketball Coaches, and she was coordinating large-scale hospitality programs at the Final Four. Sharon is now the founder of Field Experience, a company that provides training and internships for college students who want to work in the event marketing industry. She'll tell us all about that and more today from the bridge. Welcome, Sharon.
Hey, Rick. How are you?
I'm great. I know you're spending summer at the beach in North Carolina. Where are you these days?
We have a beach house in Emerald Isle, North Carolina, and it is about an hour and a half north of Wilmington and 2.5 hours east of Raleigh, or should I say east of UNC, NC State, and Duke.
Yeah, I love Emerald Isle. It's a great, great place. You know, I live at the beach. I live on an island, and I always tell people that when I fly, I cross three bridges coming home. I land in Charleston, and I cross the Ashley River Bridge on 526, and my blood pressure goes down several points. And then I cross the Limehouse Bridge, which takes me from the mainland to John's Island, and my blood pressure falls another 5 points. And then I cross little old Church Creek on the Wadmalaw Island, and all the worries are gone. So I know that bridge at Emerald Isle. I feel like that's probably the same thing for you.
It is. And one of the things the city did years ago that I love, and it happens about this time of the year, the road to the bridge is they plant sunflowers. So there could be thousands and thousands of sunflowers. And then you hit that bridge and you see that low coastal water, and you're absolutely right. I always think of it as kind of like shedding. And you sort of shed as you go over that bridge, and then you can like breathe, and it's a great place to be.
Yeah, I love that analogy because I feel the same way. I mean, I know the bridges, and I just go, and then really, because we both have always traveled so darn much. And I read a really interesting thing on Facebook this week about somebody being stuck trying to get to Atlanta, and you know, you're on a plane and they won't leave, and baby's crying and everybody's mad, you know, and so we've all been there. And then you get to land and you get to cross the bridge, and it gets a lot better from that.
That's right. That's why I have probably about 30 seconds of the ocean on my phone. So when I am in those airports with those screaming babies, I can just turn it on and just be there.
Well, let's start today. We always start with all our guests, kind of, you know, where are you from? Where'd you grow up? That sort of thing. I think you're Canadian, aren't you?
I was dual citizenship, but I didn't listen to my parents and didn't fill out the paperwork. So I'm a full-blown American.
Oh, okay.
Landed immigrant in Canada. I was born at the University of Syracuse when my father was doing his PhD in education.
Wow. So you...
But I didn't know what an orangeman was.
You didn't know what an orangeman was, you know?
Until 2009 when I was working, and they made it to the tournament.
Well, Syracuse originally were the Warriors. People don't know this. They had a Native American mascot, and they were one of the first to become politically correct and eliminated the Native American reference and became the Orange, and obviously have a cool mascot with the Orange. That's a lot of fun. So, what was your first job?
My first job was in Australia. I grew up all over the world in almost every socioeconomic level. So lived in Nigeria, Malawi, the Philippines. And then my father was doing sabbatical in Australia. And my brother and I were hired. I think we were a little bit underage, but we had American accents. And we were hired by a American ice cream parlor called Auntie's.
Because they wanted the American accent. I love that. You know, we did a program several years ago leading into the 2000 Olympic Games in Sydney. We did a program called the Down Under Tour for Bank of America. And our research had shown that aspirationally more Americans wanted to go to Australia than any other place. And I guess it was because of, you know, Paul Hogan in that era, Shrimp on the Barbie, all that kind of stuff. And they spoke, you know, some form of English. We did this tour. We did a traveling tour, went to 60 markets in the United States. The entire experience was shaped like the Sydney Opera House. So it was white tents that were kind of in that sail shape and had all kinds of experiences. But the really cool thing is we hired students from the Australian Tourist Board. So all of our brand ambassadors were Australians. And so you had a better experience when, you know, people could actually talk that way. So this was the reverse for you. You were the American accent in an ice cream parlor.
Even though I was Canadian, but they kind of looked at it the same.
Yeah, exactly. It all blends together. We laugh about that. We met when you were at Prime Sport. And who was the guy, David, that was the CEO of Prime Sport in that era? I'm trying to think his last name.
So that was David Lord.
Yeah, David loved him. Yeah.
Yes. I was working for the NFL at the time under Jim Stieg. And Jim was leaving. And I Prime Sport had raised, I think it was $26 million with Razor Gator. And that was the beginning of a paradigm shift in the ticket world. And they hired me to create the experiences around the game ticket.
Now, what had you done for Jim at the NFL before? What was your job?
I was hired in 1999 to work with another woman, Debbie Wardrop, and we created the corporate hospitality, which became on location, which became purchased by Endeavor. So that was at the very, very beginning of creating experiences for corporations that were involved in the Super Bowl.
I saw recently where that organization has bought the exclusive hospitality rights for the LA Olympic Games.
Yes.
And so it's going to be fascinating. And, you know, that used to be not one company had all that. You had lots of companies that were feeding that trough in different ways. And so it's going to be interesting to see how well that model works for them. We worked together initially at the Final Four. And one of the things that I really loved about working with you was that you took the time to understand the individual needs of the hospitality patron. You know, you didn't treat everybody the same. You said, no, you know, who are you entertaining? What are you doing? What's your objectives? And I really love that. You know, it never felt one-stop shopping. It always felt, even if it wasn't, it always felt pretty customized. And obviously we had all the coaches. And we were, you know, using coaches for brand ambassadors and doing hospitality. But you had a lot of other really great celebrities that would be part of the hospitality program. Talk a little bit about that.
So when I was with Prime Sport, we partnered in 2007 with the NCAA. And you have to understand, and I appreciate that you said it the way I took the time. I had to take the time. Going into college sports, coming from Canada that has a total of 101 universities, and I went to University of Guelph. There's only 22 universities in Ontario, and I think less at that time. And our school wasn't really good enough to go national. So that was my reference. I moved to the U.S., and I don't get involved in sports until 1992, and I really don't. And then I start dabbling into college sports, and there's over 4,000 universities and colleges. that was probably the hardest part of my job, was really understanding all the dynamics. And over the years, this was my fourth industry, but I realized that I loved creating access for extraordinary events. And that carried me through the four industries. Sports was one of them, and it was very exciting. And over the years, I realized I was more of a fan of the fan. I love that
description. That's a great description. Fan of the fan.
Well, I would end up being, whether it was 50-yard line, and I would be looking the other way at everyone's faces, or I would look around the stadium or the arena at the people that were there. Why are they there? And really the amount of money that people spend to go to these events can be significant. And it was important to create an experience that they ordinarily wouldn't have. And, you know, with the NCAA and the NFL and the Olympics, I really had a front row seat at some extraordinary moments in people's lives, whether it was an athlete that made that one shot to a championship, but it was also all the people that were there. And that's really what my why is. The hardest part was whether I was being interviewed about who I thought was going to win. And I always had to take notes and have someone on my team that would give me stats and make sure I didn't mix up Auburn and Alabama or Michigan and Michigan State, which I often did.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting to have the view of not being such a fan yourself of the specific event or team, so that you have a different sort of perspective of how do we serve the people that are. You know, I found in many cases, you know, people are too much fans themselves to realize anything other than their own self-gratification. And so they don't see the forest for the trees. And y'all always did that.
We were intentional, and sometimes we would plan things. So you know, you talk about the celebrities. I was in Houston that I started doing research about something called Phi Slamma Jamma. And I probably said the name wrong because I'm constantly putting my foot in my mouth.
No, you got it right. That's Guy Lewis's team. That was a great team, yeah.
That was. So, you know, I love controversial conversations with celebrities that played against Jalen Rose and Christian Laettner. I had Christian Laettner booked for Indianapolis Final Four. Heard Jalen Rose was in town, and then learned about the 30-30 I hate Christian. I said, hey, would you be willing to have a conversation? And it turned into this incredible conversation. Like 400 people were in one living room sitting around talking. And that's when I turn around from looking at them on stage to the people that they're talking to, and they're lighting up. And that's when I know I have a home run. Actually, when I know I had a home run, it was when I would look at a corporate executive, a CEO that's been there, done that, and I saw that that what we had done had brought the child out in him or her.
Yeah, I love that. You know, there are people that we deal with, obviously, that pretty much can buy anything they want. But to give them that experience that really money can't buy, you know, that uniqueness that you said, it brings the child out to them. It brings, they go back to where they were. They remember, you know, all those kinds of things. And when you touch that level, then I think, you know, you're going to be successful, and they're going to return, you know, year in and year out, as part of that. And it's hard to do. I mean, it's hard to capture magic every year and every event and all the times. But I always felt like y'all did such
Thank
a great
you.
Job. And one of the things that you did that I think is a nice segue to what you're doing now is, you know, you were great about teaching young people the craft. You know, Brittany Shell and I were talking once about, you know, all the young people that worked under you at Prime Sport, and they were just a joy to work with. And I think, you know, the speed of the ship's always been been determined by the speed of the captain, and you were able to train people to do things. And that's not easy to do, especially if you're starstruck yourself. You know, if you're a young person and here you are at the Super Bowl, or here you are at the Final Four, and you realize, you know, you're not here to be a fan. You're here to serve the fans. That's not easy to do, and yet y'all seem to pull that off almost effortlessly. And now I think it's kind of led you to what you're doing now. But talk a little bit about teaching and training young people.
Well, it goes back to, for me, it goes back to my father being a professor, a world-renowned professor of international comparative education and workforce development. If someone ever said, "Oh, you're gonna go into that," I would have laughed at them because I thought it was really boring. But as I worked, you know, my years at the Georgia Dome on the opening management team in the NFL, I realized that selfishly, you know, there could be 20, maybe 100 people in the boardroom. But in order to pull off these events, you needed hundreds or thousands of people that needed to be on the same page. And I always sought out, we needed people that had a stake in the game. And it was really that sport and entertainment student that had the stake in the game. In 2000 and I can't remember my years now, but it was probably about 6 or 7 years ago in Houston. I met a professor, and I knew a lot of professors and I use a lot of students, but I met my co-founder of Field Experience, Dr. Joey Lynn Bielkowski. And while I was looking for these eager students, she was looking for real authentic experiential learning that started before an event and didn't include just holding up a welcome sign. We realize that in order to get the most out of the students in the workforce was starting with transferable soft skills. And I know that can be a little loosey-goosey, but in order for self-awareness or critical thinking or problem solving, and then on the other side, empowering them and giving them a little bit of power themselves to deal with situations, because events are incredibly chaotic. You have multiple organizations coming together for a short period of time. Everyone has their own agendas and own way of doing things. And with the students and the training that Joey Lynn and I did over the 6 years, we realized that we had something here. And when we had students that were really more focused, or not even just students, but staff that were more focused on the celebrities, we made it clear that that wasn't why they were there. And every event we had an MVP award, somebody that would work above and beyond and be voted as the MVP of the event. And then at the end, we always did something special for them, whether it's a meet and greet, with a celebrity or a coach. So we manage their expectations, have low expectations at the beginning, you're here to work. And what happened was a lot of our students people thought that they were junior executives. We had our CTO at Prime Sport say, you know, I was really impressed with those two junior executives that you have. Were they from the Raleigh office? I said, no, they were students, and I made them wear business attire. So here we are at a sporting event, but when a student puts on a tie and a jacket or a business attire dress, they're going to have more confidence. And that was really the start of it.
You know, it's interesting about soft skills. I think the one soft skill I have is I smile at everybody. Smiling is just so disarming. I mean, you just smile at everybody. And you know, people inevitably smile back. And it kind of changes the dynamic of that. I know that Chick-fil-A is an organization that's one of the things they teach all their young people. Hey, when somebody comes up to order, just smile first before you do anything else.
It's universal.
Yeah,
it's
works.
It's universal.
It does. It works in so many ways. Every one of our podcasts has a theme, and today's theme is about preparation. And now what you've done is you've taken all these things that you saw through, you know, various points in your career, and then you decide to be an entrepreneur. You decide to go start something based on what you saw lacking in the marketplace. And that leads us to field experience.
That's right. So that's right. And Joey Lynn and I realized that we had a business model. And our angel investor, Stu Lichter, who is what is a landowner and developer of the Hall of Fame Village in Canton, Ohio, realized what we were doing. And we decided to create a digital platform that started in the industry that we knew, but then would expand into any industry. Because the skills were are transferable, and that feeling of empowerment and our vision of having a prepared, engaged, and inclusive future workforce started. And what I don't recommend is launching a startup 3 months before a global pandemic.
Yeah, no. Timing was not so fortuitous. You know, one of the frustrations that I have seen I think there are about 380 schools, either at the undergraduate or graduate level, giving degrees in sport management, and yet they're really not prepared for jobs. You know, we've kind of, oh, you can work in the wonderful world of sport or the wonderful world of entertainment, and you know, every time I have our young people unloading boxes for our tours in, you know, 100-degree weather, I laughingly say, welcome to the glamorous world of sports mm-hmm. marketing. But y'all really saw that there was a need for both soft skill development, but also, you know, competencies, hard skills in certain
That's
areas.
Right.
And that you felt like you could build scalable processes in order to do that. Talk a little bit about that. And just talk about your vision for the company and the model that you're building.
The model has slightly changed due to pivoting with the pandemic. But basically, the learning logic that Joey Lynn's brought to field experience and our process of learn, experience, connect. So the learning component is starting from very basic, and it's a gamified platform. Everyone starts as a rookie, comes in and takes a career-ready course, and then they sign up for a micro-internship, and they're literally airdropped into probably one of the most chaotic environments, which are events. You don't know. There's so many unknowns, and they actually use those skills. And then we use the connect component where they're connecting their experience back to the skills and what they're learning. But also, as a freshman or a high school senior, they're connecting their network and they're starting to build their network. A lot of universities don't start internships until, you know, sophomore, junior year. But let's start it early. Let's start developing it. And I would say there's a pretty significant percentage of students that will be involved in a micro internship think they love where they're going and come back after and say, you know, I had so much fun at Super Bowl, but I realize I prefer to be behind the scenes in front instead of in front of crowds. And we realize that we've saved that young person probably a year or maybe more learning what works for them and what doesn't. I thought it was going to be this.
Yeah, that is so important. You've said a couple of things that I really like. One is I tell our young sales guys and gals, you're going to sell generationally. You know, if you're a 25-year-old in the business selling, you're going to sell to the same people for the next 40 years. It's a generational thing, and you cannot build a big enough Rolodex, in my opinion. It's all about mm-hmm. connectivity. And you're already showing young people early, get connected to your peer group. But secondly, we have a couple of interns this summer at Fishbait Solutions. And I told them the objective was to figure out what they didn't want to do. Not what they wanted to do. Just eliminate things you said. I thought I wanted to do that, but I really don't want to do that. That's not what I want to do. That's the process of elimination. And y'all, because you put them literally, you know, maybe out of the frying pan into the fire, really quickly, then the emotional piece kicks in that you go, either I like this or I don't like this. And I think that's, not only does it save them time, it saves them money in terms of going down paths that are the wrong paths.
That's right. And they start seeing their superpowers at, it was Super Bowl in Miami in 2020. We, on our chat, we got a student that said, I just came across two very unhappy people and a happy face emoji, but I use my empathy skills and, they went from unhappy to happy. And we could have taught them that in a classroom. We could have told them that. Their parents could have told them about that, but she needed to experience that. And that aha moment that I have the power to change a situation for the positive.
Well, I love that. We talk a lot on this podcast about identifying your gifts. You know, if you have gifts and you have a passion, then you're going to be able to have a great career and a great life around that. But again, you know, I've got a saying, all sunshine and no rain makes a desert. And the truth is, there are going to be those rainy days when you've got to pivot, you got to change, you got to change behaviors. You got to take unhappy people and make them happy. My mama, who was a fine Southern Baptist lady, one of her favorite expressions was, honey, sometimes you got to tell people to go to hell and make them look forward to the trip. And, you know, and in a COVID world with all these restrictions, yep, and masks and distancing and all the kinds of crazy, we have to make people look forward to the trip. You know, the great news for what you're doing is I think the pandemic probably sharpened y'all's saws. It made you say, okay, let's dive it down to what really matters. How do we give students what, and other organizations, what really, really matters to change behaviors. The great news is we're going to have a decade where events are going to be just more and more, and it's going to blow up. I mean, I tell everybody, you know, 1918, 1919 Spanish flu led to the Roaring Twenties, and the key to the Roaring Twenties was that was the golden age of sport, baseball, boxing, horse racing, and the golden age of motion pictures, where people went to movie theaters. And I'm seeing right now, as we recover from this craziness, this enormous demand for people to get back to festivals, to sporting events, to concerts, to trade shows, to any place with other human beings. And you're going to be able to place students in meaningful, well-paying jobs, which I think is exciting.
Yes. And actually, I think this pandemic turned our business model upside down, and we weren't going, when they started shutting down events, we looked at our timeline and said, well, we're not supposed to be going, we don't have us going into another industry till 2022, but we did. We pivoted. We actually brought in a wonderful, like-minded CEO, Angela Robb, and went more on the enterprise. She brought in Chewy.com, and we realized our model wasn't just for the students. It start with students and then throughout your career, because you can always reskill, upskill. And a lot of recent graduates. So what the pandemic did for us was realize we really believe that workforce should be lifelong learners and make it fun.
Yeah, I love that. I love that reskill, upskill, because that's the reality. You know, the microprocessor is changing so rapidly that there's more power in your smartphone than there was on the rocket that went to the moon. And
right.
And the rate of change is so dramatic that really the most important skill, I think, is the skill to learn new skills.
An open mindset or an infinite mindset, always want to learn.
Yeah, and I think, you know, one of the tragedies, in my opinion, of the last administration in Washington was this false belief that we were going to go back to the 1950s again, that we were going to go back to to making stuff like we did in the 1950s, and we're going to go back to making the sausage like we did. Well, we're not. We're not ever going to go back. I mean, you are only going forward. You can learn from the past, but, you know, it's about what's right. next, and having those kinds of adaptable skills. And I think part of it is a mindset. If you're getting young people early on to realize you have to be a lifetime learner, there's no way around it. You have to be. That's valuable, and that's something that you're kind of overlaying to them right from the get-go.
That's right, and it's not just sport and entertainment students. I would say that my daughter Lucy was that socially awkward STEM student that preferred to do things alone, but when she worked our events, she built that other side and those social skills that now she's a biochemistry senior at Georgia Tech at interviews saying, you know, I prefer to work in a lab, but I have the skills that I can explain what I'm doing to the C-level, to marketing and PR. Same thing with finance students. We've had many finance students build out those skills. And they can use it in any career that they want. And that's the beauty of what we're seeing happening with these young people.
Well, again, even those introverts in the lab, at some point you've got to convince someone to give you money to fund research,
exactly.
to continue to help you, you know, promote what you're doing. And so all these skills are so critically important. You know, I do tell everybody, at the end of the day, all of us are in the people business. And people skills are critical to long-term success.
That's right.
Well, what's next for Field Experience as we now come out of the pandemic? We go back to events. You've got more enterprise solutions for more of the Chewy, organizations. Tell me what's your vision for the company?
The vision for the company really is to expand that. We are reopening our micro internship component. We dabbled in it slightly, but we really focused on building our library of lessons in our technology. So while we are doing the enterprise component, a big focus, and we're working with multiple universities, is to continue what we started with. And the vision hasn't wavered. So we're excited about that. One thing that happened during the pandemic that was a surprise, the NCAA asked us to manage the Next Gen program. And we started to do that for Men's Final Four and work with Georgia Tech for Atlanta. And it was an innovation summit. It didn't happen. They asked us to do it again for 2021, and we did completely virtual, but we created a really interesting digital learning journey that wove in the NCAA strategic priorities and also with the stakeholders, including opportunities for sponsors. We did a pilot program, and we ended up exceeding expectations, and we'll be growing that program. Staying true to our business model and what we're focused on, we also wove in things like critical thinking, belonging, and civility. So all of that learning goes alongside with our soft skills, but also with very cool stories and a lot of legends. A lot of the NCAA legends want to give back in that case for the next generation. So that's something that I'm most interested in. Our team is really fine-tuning the technology and taking us to another level. But that's a project, a passion project for me.
Well, we're big believers in what you're doing. You know, we've partnered with you on a project and plan to continue to do more. How can people out there listening find out more about Field Experience?
Certainly go to fieldexperience.com, and it's spelled field, F-I-E-L-D, and then a letter X, P-E-R-I-E-N-C-E, or myfieldx.com, or email me at Sharon@myfieldx.com.
Well, there's exciting times ahead for you and your company, and we thank you so much for being with us today from the bridge.
And Rick,
yes, ma'am.
It's always a pleasure talking with you.
Thank you.
It was great. Next time we have to do it over good food.
Yes, we need to do it overlooking the sea, eating good food someplace. I'm all up for that.
I'll meet you halfway.
That'd be great. All right, talk soon. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Let's close today's show with another fun place to eat on the road with Rick. Since Sharon is spending her summer at the beach, let's talk about a great beach roadhouse. When we lived in London, the long, cold, dark, miserable winters could get to you. So each February, we ran to the sun. We'd head to the Florida Keys, Almirada to be specific, and the Chica Lodge to be even more specific. One of the best places to eat down there is right in the heart of Almirada at the Whale Harbor Marina. It's Wahoo's Bar and Grill. The view is incredible and the food is even better. Grab yourself a rum punch and some conch fritters, a little ceviche, and steamed Gulf shrimp. Then move on to wonderful grilled fish, mahi-mahi, grouper, maybe some snapper, or maybe a Florida lobster or some stone crabs in their respective seasons. For dessert, come on. Of course it's key lime pie made with local key limes. It's the perfect place after a day of fishing or swimming or both. It's Wahoo's at mile marker 83.5 on A1A along the road to Key West on the road with Rick. That's a wrap for today. Thanks for being with us. And let us hear how we're doing. If you like us, let some other folks know about us. We'll see you next week right back here from the bridge.